All right, last chance. No more? No more? Just want to encourage you, continue to encourage you. Take every opportunity to be able to be a light. In the Bible, we are called to be the salt and the light, right? Light, walk into a room, the light's there. But salt is actually when you come in, salt is only useful when you come in contact with something. You put it into something, right? Then you can it's useful. Light is almost like when people watch your life, they're like, I want what that person has. I don't know what it is, but they are a man, a woman of integrity. They do this, they do that, they live this out. That's the light aspect. The salt aspect is when we actually come in contact with people. Is that making sense? It's when we come in contact with people. We have friends that are in need and we meet that need. We pray with them. There are people around us that God calls us to give a word to, an encouragement, a hug even. And you go do that, you come in contact with them, salt and light. It's two ways. It's not just they see your life. It's the Bible calls us to be both. Share with you a quick story, and then I'm going to get into the message, okay? This one, I was like, I go to the gym there in Fit for Less, that one. It's like $10 a month. Really awesome. And I told God, you know what, God? Here, I'm just going to relax. I'm not going to worry about anything. I'm just going to, this is how I clear my mind. I was walking out of the gym, and one of the what do you call them? They're like the person in charge there. I don't want to say cashier, but one of the receptionists. Yes, receptionist. They were standing there. She God in the corner of my eye just caught her, and God was like, "You gotta pray for her." And I'm like, "No, Lord, I gotta go. I'm busy. I gotta do this. I gotta do that." And so I prolonged and I wrestled with God for about a week and a half. Because he just won't budge forward. And so for about a week and a half, I was like, God, no, don't worry about it. She'll be fine. Send somebody else. And so I was like, all right, God, you won't leave me alone for about a week and a half. He keeps speaking to me. He's like, this one's an emergency. And I'm like, what emergency? I don't know this person and stuff like that. I don't know anything about her. He's like, this, digita bibitawan with this one. I'm not going to let you go with this one because this is an emergency. It's a big deal here. And I'm like, I don't know why. And so about a week and a half ago, I went to the gym and I was there. And he's like so strong telling me, go pray for this person. Just go up to them. Just go love them. And I'm like, ah, God, fine. Okay, I'm going to do it. And so I come up to her. I'm like, this is really weird. And you can say no. You can absolutely say no. But I've been feeling for the last about week and a half or 2 weeks that God wants me to pray for you. And you can absolutely say no. I don't have to do this. And she's like, oh my gosh. And she's like, you're going to make me cry. And yeah, legit. This was happening right there in the middle of Fit for Less. And so I was like, oh no, what happened? Why? And she's like, you have no idea what's happening. I just got out of an abusive relationship and all this. And she starts pouring her heart out. I'm like, oh ma'am, I just want to tell you that all the more that I couldn't escape this. I was telling her, I couldn't escape. It's like God really wanted you to know that she needs a touch from me. She needs to know that I'm here for her, you know? And so I prayed for her there. And you know what? I went back there just a couple days ago, and she's like, you need to come here every day. You need to pray for me every day, man. And so, yeah, give God a round of applause. Give God a round of applause. But how many opportunities like those, how many people miss out on the touch from God because we remain silent, right? I used to be ashamed that people would find out that I'm a Christian. And they're like, oh, you're a Christian? You go to church? I'm like, yes. I used to be like that. But now I'm ashamed and embarrassed if somebody realizes or notices that I'm a Christian and they don't see any difference in my life. I look and sound like everybody else. I talk like everybody else. I do things the same as everybody else. In the Bible, we're called to be salt and light. That means we're going to stick out like a sore thumb because in a world that is compromising, we will stand our ground in integrity. Is that making sense? Now I'm scared. I'm scared people will find out I'm a Christian and I look and sound like everybody else, so I'm just going to represent Jesus wherever I go. And I want to challenge you the same thing. Please, 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 please. And it doesn't have to look like the way I do it. You are unique in the way that God called you to. You are unique in the circle of influence that God entrusted you with. How are you using that influence for good? How are you using that influence to share God so that he can be known in one way, shape, or form? Again, it looks different for everybody. But But we have to be living intentionally every day, not just once a week, where we put on this, we're going to go to church, so that means we are religious, that means we are holy. No. It's so much more than that. Jesus, and that's what I'm going to talk about today, why Jesus died. Jesus died for far more than just to get us into heaven, right? I'm quoting this from Todd White and Bill Johnson. They said, Jesus died for us so that heaven can get into us and into other people. We are those agents. We are those funnels. Get it? You know? Like the sound effects. All right, Celine, you're going to play that video. We're going to get into this message. It's going to be powerful. I got a couple illustrations for you because it is super teachy. I couldn't think of other examples except just show you. And so I have a couple examples that will hit home with it, and it will staple it into your mind. But let's play this. This is our theme for the month of April. For you who are new here, we welcome you. You're going to get to know Jesus really well. So go ahead. Fantastic. Thank you, Mr. Clyde Chan. Give him a round of applause again for that video. Absolutely beautiful. Okay, so in the last Sunday, Pastor Andoni started this off. Why did Jesus come? Our hopes is for this April, especially leading up to Easter, if you only know Jesus in a shallow level, that you would meet him and know him, more about him in a deeper level, so much so that it drives you into wanting to know more about him, to learn more about his life, what he taught, how he lived, and then in turn, we'll do the same thing for your life. Last week, Pastor Andoni covered why Jesus came. He said that Jesus came to reveal God. He is the embodiment of God. He is God incarnate. That means God embodied. He came to ransom us, to pay for a price that we could never pay. That is our sin, our fallenness, our shortcoming, our transgression. He came for that. He came to release abundant life over us, like we find in John 10:10. The thief comes to kill, to steal, to destroy. You notice there, it's always taking away. Steal, kill, destroy. It always takes away. But Jesus says, I have come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. The enemy takes, Jesus gives. And finally, he said, Jesus came to receive us into his family. This morning, we are going to be tackling why Jesus died. It is such a common thing. You see it everywhere. You don't have to go far. You just need to turn on the TV, and there is one way, shape, or form, some kind of word about Jesus or something like that. You notice in TV, Hollywood, and everything like that, the name Jesus is actually like a curse word. You notice that? My wife and I watch a lot of TV, and every time I hear it, it kind of makes me cringe a bit. You know? It does, right? People are like, oh, man, this happened. Jesus Christ, right? Something like that. It makes you cringe a bit because when you love something, when you love somebody, you don't want their name being used in a perverted way. You know what I mean? So it makes you kind of cringe a little bit like that. So one way, shape, or form, you can see it all throughout our society. Jesus this, Jesus that. But the idea is, why did Jesus die? Why did Jesus die? And the simple answer is, it's for our sins, right? That's the Sunday school answer. Jesus died for our sins. But in order for us to fully appreciate what he did, we need to be able to kind of go through this problem-solving thing that I'm gonna tell you about here, but I don't want to go too far away from my notes here. Let me share this with you, and then again, I will show two illustrations that will bring this home for you. Why did Jesus have to die? Why did Jesus die the way he did? Understanding why it had to be Jesus and why Jesus did what he did helps us better appreciate the finished work of Jesus Christ. But on the other hand, not fully understanding these two questions lead Christians into misconceptions, complacency, or just blatant rejection of Jesus and what he stands for and all of that. Am I making sense here? Not fully understanding these two questions, why Jesus died or why he died the way he did, leads Christians to misconceptions. Misconceptions looking like, do you know, I think I'm saying the name right. It's called penitentia. Penitentia. Okay. You know, you're like, they're in the Philippines. I grew up in Zambales. My mom's from there. And we would see people marching, like, you know, they're crucifying themselves, they're hurting themselves, like blood. Somebody told me it's actually just ketchup. It's not really blood. But they're doing that. They're punishing themselves because they have a misconception of the work that Jesus Christ did. They think that they need to add to the work that he did, the finished work. They think that they need to pay for their sins by inflicting pain on themselves. Okay, some of them even get crucified. But it's funny because after that, they go get lugaw because they're still alive. So it's not really the true essence of being crucified. So you like that, Ezra? But misconceptions. Penitential people crucifying themselves, hurting themselves to gain forgiveness because they think they have to add to what Jesus did. Complacency. If you think there's more than one way, you won't follow him. We all end up in the same place kind of mentality, right? I get this a lot. That, oh, all religions kind of just point to the same direction. We all end up there. I've had this conversation multiple times. Complacency. My big question for that is, if there is multiple ways, then why did Jesus have to go through the brutality that he went to? Why didn't he just say it? I believe he went through that because he knew that it is the only way, he is the only truth, and he's the only life, and no one comes to the Father except through him. Complacency. Not understanding why Jesus died will lead us to just blatant rejection. Because you think thoughts like, I don't want to serve God that sends people to hell and stuff like that. Not fully understanding that he sent Jesus so that we don't have to go through that. Does that make sense? Nod your head. Yeah, you're getting it. For us to better understand why Jesus died, we will need to go through a problem-solving process. Because I believe one can better understand and fully appreciate what is made available for us when we have a fuller perspective of the problem, the solution, and the process. My parents, when you are young, you have such a limited perspective. When I was young, everybody who's young just has such a limited perspective. You see your parents come home, you see them leave, but it's not until you're older and you actually start working yourself that you fully appreciate what they did for you, the last 15, 16, 17, 20 years of your life. You take it for granted. But once you know the hardship, the stress, the blood, sweat, tears, and everything that they went through, in order for you to be able to have a plate on the table or a roof over your head, you appreciate it a lot more, right? A problem-solving process. That's just what I want to call it. We will go through what God saw as the problem, and then we will go through what he saw as the solution. You do this for almost everything you do. And then you think about the problem. Let's say you are hungry. Okay, I'm thinking about McDonald's. I'm hungry. I got to go for lunch. Okay, what's the solution? The solution is I'm going to get something to eat. Where? Wendy's, McDonald's, wherever. Well, how do you get from point A to point B? That's the process. My car is broken. Oh, no. Okay, so I got to get it fixed. What's the solution? Go to a mechanic. Okay, how do I get from point A to point B where my car is broken and the car is fixed? Well, you got to think about how you're going to bring your car to the mechanic. You're going to have to think about how you're going to do this. That's the process. Am I making sense here? You do this for, if you really think about it, you do this for almost everything that you do in life. You recognize a problem, you recognize a solution, and then you kind of brainstorm, how do we get from point A to point B? Everybody that gets this, say amen. Good. Okay. What we find here, and this is what we're going to dissect that I'm going to do. I'm going to paint you a picture, and then we are going to see where the Holy Spirit takes us. What we are going to be going through is, first, what God saw as the problem. And that problem is a no-brainer for all of you. It's sin. It's our fallen nature. Sin, the separation from God. That's what he saw as the problem. What was the solution? The man named Jesus Christ. That's the solution. That he is going to be making a way. Because when there is sin, when there is impurity, when there is that thing that separates us from God, what happens is there is a wall that is right beside us, and God is on the other side because he is holy, he is righteous, he's just. If we come in contact with him, we'll die in our impurities. And then the process, what's the process? The process is the sacrifice. So God, looking at humanity, saw it and said, oh man, big problem, sin, came through Adam and Eve. What's the solution? Man, we got to make a way. Jesus' solution. What's the process? There's got to be a sacrifice because the law has to be fulfilled. And we're going to talk about that, okay? So we're going to go with the first one here. All right, if you have notes, you want to write this down. I put the Bible verses up there. But if you have your Bibles, feel free to have them too. Highlight them and stuff like that. How many of you actually have your Bibles? Put your hand up. Okay, about three of you. That's really good. How many of you actually have your Bibles? Put it up there. This is your weapon. This is the living word of God. All right. Seven of you this time. All right. How many of you actually have their Bibles? All right. Nine of you this time. This is really good. We're getting up there. How many of you have your Bibles in an app or something like that? Anything? Put your hand up. All right. That's better. It's good. It's good to not be lazy in church. They're like, man, I got to put my hand up. Oh, I got to go say hi to people. Oh, man, it's just so hard. Yeah, it's going to be okay. We're teaching you guys to be fit. That's exercising, you know. Exercising, toning up your arms. The problem we have here equals sin. For all have sinned and fallen short of God's standard. Why do we live by God's standard? Because it's God's universe. He's the one that created it. So he is the standard here. The dictionary definition of sin, you preach up here. The dictionary definition of sin is an immoral act considered to be transgression against divine law. An immoral act considered to be transgression against divine law. The Hebrew and Greek definition of sin, they have several. They have a couple. Bent or crooked. Breach of trust, revolt, to miss the mark, or just disobedience. This is the Hebrew and Greek definition of what sin is whenever sin is used in the context of the verses that we use here. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fallen short of God's standard. Sin entered and has had dominion over creation since Adam. Okay? Adam and Eve, we find them just dwelling. That's the most beautiful part about the Garden of Eden. It's not that the garden was beautiful. It's that God dwelt with them. Amen? It's that God walked with them, dwelt with them, talked with them, fellowshiped with them, guided them, just person to person. No mediator, no high priest, no anything. Just Adam and Eve and God. And what happened is disobedience was committed by Eve and then Adam. And what happened? Now there is a severance. There is a severance. God says, you can't stay here anymore because if you do, you're going to die. Because I'm holy and my holiness means I hate sin. And now sin is inside of you. It's dwelling in you. Something shifted. And when we talk about sin, let's get this clear. Sin and what Jesus died for is not just a few actions. It's not. It's the very desire of your heart. That's according to Rabbi Zacharias. That's why when we come to Jesus, what changes is not just a few actions. You can go to therapy for that. You can go to one of those things where you sit around, hi, my name is Richard, and I'm an alcoholic and stuff like that, and change your behavior. It goes beyond that, and it goes to the heart, to the soul, where the desires of your heart actually shifts. Instead, from things that are destructive, they become constructive, and they become to the glory of God. Am I making sense? It's the very heart of it that changes. It's not just a few actions. The problem is that, catch this, okay? The problem is that sin has poisoned the system that God created. Sin is a cancer, okay? You can't put a Band-Aid on cancer. when you think that what God or what Jesus died for is just a few actions, a few, disobedience or something like that, or doing something when no one else is watching kind of thing. If you think that's it, that's like putting Band-Aid and you have cancer. No, you got to get the proper treatment for that. You got to get the right meds. It's got to go inside deep, not just on the surface level. Is that making sense? Sin is the cancer of creation, slowly killing those who are bound by it. And we find this in Romans 6:23. The wages of sin is death. It's just like how when there's gravity, you'll be pulled down. It is a natural law. Sin equals death. And you see that with a lot of people. You see that with people who are in prison. You see that with people who have committed all sorts of just crimes. They didn't just decide that one day. It is a culmination. Sometimes it is just an accident or something like that. But it is an everyday decision to compromise, to sin. And that seed of sin is planted in there and it grows. Pretty soon it'll bear fruit, destructive fruit. And sin, we find in James 1:15, when it is fully grown, gives birth to what? To death. Okay, one more. You guys sound like your energy level. So sin, when it is fully grown, gives birth to? It's like me having an exam in front of you and I gave you the answer. So sin, when it is fully grown, gives birth to? Awesome. Oh man, okay, we're going to try that again. It's like you are on your grade 12 year or your university, your thesis, and I gave you the answer. What would you be like? Yeah, right? So sin, when it's fully grown, gives birth to? There you go. Give yourselves a round of applause. That's good. But we got to pump some more coffee into you. We got to get that Barocco stuff. See, we don't have to look far to see our fallen nature, because the tendency when we start talking about sin is we start to think, oh, I'm not that bad. I mean, some people have done worse. Some people have done this. Some people have done that. I'm not that bad. But remember, when you are serving and living in the universe created by a holy and just God, not a stain on him, even the slightest stain is a stain in his eyes. Does that make sense? It's not, you stole candy, so it's not as bad, and then I robbed a bank, so it's pretty bad. No, it's all in the eyes of God. It's all just one thing, just leveled. We don't have to look far to see our fallen nature. Apart from Jesus, we see it in our thought life when no one is watching. We see it in our self-centered tendencies. We see it in a wider scale, like in the 20th century. Did you know that the 20th century, according to Ravi Zacharias, is the bloodiest century thus far? Without God's moral standard under communism and a whole bunch of other reasons that's just selfish, we see when man holds all the power without any guiding principles but himself, a ripple of death sweeps through humanity. Is that true? When left unchecked, we are destructive, we are selfish, we are manipulative, fallen and in absolute need of a Savior. It's not just in a few actions, it's in the very core of us. Sin in its very essence equals death. Harm for yourselves and harm for the people around you. Sin is a corrupted version of God's original intent. It is the problem. What is the problem? Sin. So God saw it. Problem, it's sin. And then he brainstormed in heaven and he said, what is the solution? The solution we find here, it's, what is it? The solution is, oh man, the exam paper is so big right now, like the answer sheet is right here. And so the solution is Jesus. There you go. More away. Good. All right. We are going to read, won't you turn to Hebrews 14? Let's tackle Hebrews 14 right now. It's a really rich verse. Hebrews 14. Hebrews 10 pala. Wala pa lang Hebrews 14. Lagot kayo kapag ito ang preacher niya. Okay. Hebrews 10:14 pala. Starting in verse 14 here. Hebrews 10. Okay, I'm messing you up here. It's not Hebrews 10:14. It's just Hebrews 10. Okay, listen to this. I'm going to read this to you, okay? Don't let me lose you. Hebrews 10, go to Hebrews 10, not 14, just Hebrews 10, okay? If you went to Hebrews 14, there's a problem. Your Bible might not be right. So Hebrews 10, okay, I'm going to follow along with me, okay? For the law, having a shadow of the good things to come and not the very image of the things, can never with these same sacrifices, which they offer continually year by year, make those who approach perfect. For then would they not have ceased to be offered? For the worshipers, once purified, would have had no more consciousness of sin. See, he's talking about after they're purified, the heart of it should have changed. It's not just a band-aid. It should be the very heart of it. ...of sins every year. For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats could take away these sins. We needed a permanent sacrifice, a perfect sacrifice here. John 14:6, we have it there, no? Jesus says, I am the way, he is the truth, and he is the life. No one comes to the Father except through him. The question is, why was Jesus the solution? What were the requirements to be the solution? Or for the Jewish religion, why the Messiah? What is the qualification of the Messiah, the Savior? Well, first of all, we find, again, now you can write it down, Hebrews 10:14, where it says, they required a perfect sacrifice. I'm going to read 10:14 here. For by one offering, he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. So this is Jesus. This is the work of Jesus Christ. What are the requirements? What made Jesus the best candidate to be the Messiah here? This is just a few of many. It needed a perfect sacrifice. Sinless and pure. We find this in Leviticus 17:1. You can write that down if you want. The sacrifice needed to be sinless and pure. And you're probably thinking in the back of your head, if you're a critical thinker, why does it need to be a sacrifice? Well, we're going to answer that in the last point here, okay? So Leviticus 17:1, sinless and pure. And from the line of David, okay, that's the next one. They got to be from the line of David. 2 Samuel 7:13. Another requirement, he's got to be willing. Not many people, not anybody really would be willing to die for the sins of the world, especially looking at the brutality that Jesus went through. Jesus is the solution. But here is where it kind of becomes mind-blowing for me, especially. Okay? Jesus, the solution. Jesus is unique. Don't let me lose you here, okay? Jesus is unique in that he was God incarnate. That means God, the embodiment of God, okay? God emptying himself and stepping into time, finite time, and he becomes man named Jesus. Jesus is unique in that he was God incarnate, God embodied. Jewish people were expecting a Messiah, but they did not expect him to be God, okay? The Messiah was not expected to be God. And so it's mind-blowing that instead of just assigning somebody, you guys need to pay attention. I'm seeing you. Please pay attention, okay? So it shocked them that it's actually God. That's why we see left, right, and center that the Pharisees and the Sadducees, they're blasphemous, because they're saying Jesus is elevating himself to the level of God. He's elevating, and they're looking at it, and it's like, no, that's not possible. A Messiah, but did not expect him to be God. Just a man that will restore Israel's military power and usher in lasting peace. God wanted to. Why did God choose to step down? Empty himself, as we find in Philippians 2:7. Empty himself and actually be the sacrifice? He could have delegated it. He absolutely could have. But why did he choose to? Here's why. God wanted to manifest his love for man. He could have assigned a prophet or another man to die for us, but instead he chose to empty himself, Philippians 2:7, and do it himself. Okay, John 10:11-13. I'm sorry, this is super teachy, but it's okay. Just keep writing notes, and then I'll bring it home to a couple illustrations for you that will just seal it in your minds. Okay, I'm going to read that again. God wanted to manifest his love for man. He could have assigned a prophet or another man to die for us, but instead, he chose to empty himself and do it himself. John 10, 11 to 13. Check this out. This is really incredible. It's not up there. John 10, 11 to 13. This is Jesus talking. He says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. And we see this exact example when it comes to the prophets of old. There are moments where they ran away, where they're too scared, or they just want to call it quits. We see that time after time. But Jesus is saying that I am not a hireling. I actually sent myself now. Then the wolf attacks the wolf and scatters. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. I'm going to give my life because you're mine. I could hire somebody, but no, I want to show you. It's always been, if you can see this with almost every religion, it's humanity trying to reach divinity, right? It's humanity trying to reach some kind of God or something like that. But here we find something incredibly unique, that it's God reaching down to humanity and saying, I want to bring you back. That is mind-blowing, because knowing how big he is, we are like a grain of sand, and yet he is willing to empty himself of divine privileges, that's what Philippians says, so that we can be reunited with a God that big? What? It is a possibility that God could have asked a righteous man or a prophet to give his life on behalf of God and for the people. But God demonstrated his love for us that while we were still sinners, he gave his life. Jesus is the solution. And what's the process? The process is the brutality of sacrifice. The process. How are we going to get from sin, separated from God, to Jesus the way and connected to God, connected back to him? How are we going to get to point A to point B here? It is through sacrifice. Blood is required. Blood needs to be shed to cancel out our sins. A sacrifice needs to be made. Why? Because the wages of sin is death. That means that when you do sin, there is a death stain on you. Is that making sense? The wages of sin, what you get as you sin, when you sin, by what you sin, is death. Why blood? Why does it need to be bloodshed? And we find that in Leviticus 17, 11. For the life of the body is in its blood. Life in the blood, death in sin. What happens? It cancels out. Is that making sense? Sin, death, blood, life. Cancels out. Is that making sense? The Old Testament covenant, the animal sacrifices, bears the weight, okay? So whatever dies basically catches the weight of the wrath of God. Because if God is not only loving, all right? Let's not get the misconception that God is only loving. He has different characteristics that make him God. One of which is holy. If you are holy, you're not just holy because you are just a title. You're holy because you hate sin. You hate impurity. If there is no impurity, it doesn't exist. There is no such thing as holiness. Am I making sense? The very idea wouldn't even exist. But because he is holy, he has to hate sin. He has to hate dirt and mess and all that stuff that comes with it, the death. The animal sacrifices bears the weight. This is what we find in the Old Testament before Jesus, where they had to sacrifice all kinds of animals so that the weight of the wrath is on that instead of the person. So the animal dies instead of the person. The animal takes the place, a pure animal takes the place of us. Jesus needed to become human simply because if he is to take the penalty of sin, which is death, he needs to be able to die because the wages of sin is death. And then we find that in Philippians 2:7. Form of a servant being born in the likeness of men. Why become human? Why not just command everyone clean? His wrath towards sin and evil, because he is just and he is holy, it had to be satisfied. And that's why we find, is it there? In Matthew 5:17 there. Do not think I came to destroy or abolish or make of no use the law. I came to fulfill it. This is Jesus talking. Don't let me lose you. Just shake it off. Don't let me lose you, okay? I'm almost done here. Don't let me lose you. He wouldn't contradict himself because he said it, therefore it is. It is the law. So if he contradicted himself, he is not holy, he's not just, he's not God. His wrath towards sin and evil, because he is just, righteous, and holy, had to be satisfied. If God contradicts his own nature, being righteous and holy, and breaks his own law, he is not perfect, not holy, not just. Something needed to be sacrificed to fulfill the law. Everybody say, fulfill the law. It's either he dies or we die. And in comes Jesus. Okay, paint your picture. Boys, can I have you guys bring the table here real quick? Okay, I have my assistants here. That's what it kind of looks like. So you know what this looks like, okay? Look at them biceps. Job. All right. Try not to make a mess out of this. But Jesus, who was the, what was the problem? Sin. Okay. What was the solution? Jesus. Okay, so the problem was sin, right? All right. What letter is this? Okay, so it's an S right there. This is my little invention because I have to pour it in, so I taped it on. Isn't that cool? S. So, who was the solution? Jesus. The cross. So everybody say, ooh. Ah. I don't know why you actually guys, why you do that. I'm just kidding. You don't actually have to do it. But you did it anyways. Thank you. That's because I asked you. That's funny. Okay. So this is Jesus. You can see he's pure. You can see the sin. It's dirty. And for us here, this is us right here. We were like Adam and Eve. We were pure. We were made so that we can dwell with God. Okay? We were made so we can dwell with God. Can everybody see this? Should I bring it up? Because I can't. It's cups. It's open. Everybody can see it? Oh, Pinky can't? Okay. We got to make sure Pinky sees this, so pray for me. All right, everybody, goodbye. Y'all have a good night. All right. So, we have here, this is humanity right here. This is us. This is us. It's you. It's me. It's all of us created in the image and likeness of God before sin came into the world. What happened when Adam sinned? All of us were stained. Okay? So what happens? Sin comes in. Lord Jesus, please, I hope this works, or otherwise it'd be really embarrassing. So, sin comes in, what happens? We are made dirty. Is that right? And this comes with all sorts of things. That's come from stealing candy, selfish nature, committing crimes, all sorts of things. This is us. And the reality is, no matter what kind of strainer or filter you use for this, it is just stuck in our very essence. It is the problem. It is in the very core of us. And we have God looking down from heaven, seeing in his wisdom that these guys aren't getting it. But I don't want them to die because I love them so much. And so I'm going to send my son, who is like me in essence. I am going to send him to die for their sins, take that penalty, take away the wages of sin. What happens? God sends Jesus and says, I'm going to die for you. I'm going to give up my life for you because I love you. And I'm going to obey the Father. What happens here? Ah, there you go. Ah, yeah. What happens is we are made pure in Jesus. And the thing is, this is amazing right here. The sin that was on Jesus could never make him impure, because he lived a blameless and sinless life. And so what happens when Jesus just comes in contact with sin, what happens there is he, even that, just destroys and kills sin right there. You see that? You guys are weird. This is what Jesus did for us. It's more than just a Band-Aid. He changed the very heart and the very core, the very desires that entangled us, that were a part of us from the very beginning. And he purified us. This is what it looks like in a little experiment. But Celine, if you want to put that video on, this is what it looks like 2,000 years ago. Okay? I want you to see it so we can fully appreciate this. Because we need to, I just believe, when we fully appreciate what Jesus Christ did for us, we have little to no reason not to give our lives to him and follow him to the very end. So if you guys want to, I know the lights here real quick. This is just a quick video, and then I'm going to wrap it up and see where the Holy Spirit takes us, okay?
Abba, Father, have your way. Though they know not what they do, let the cross draw men to you.
Everybody's sin, past, present, future, falling on one man. For us. For you. Out of obedience from a loving Father and willingness to do it. Won't you all close your eyes? I'm not trying to rile up some emotion inside of you. I'm trying to paint you a picture of how serious it is what he did for us. And that's why we live seriously for him too. It can't just be a 1 week kind of thing. A sideline kind of thing. When things go bad, we pick it up from where we left off kind of thing. It's he gave his life for us, you know? And that's why we willingly give our lives for him. And the amazing part about this is he doesn't say, you are... The amazing part is he says, I no longer call you servants, I call you friends. Let's dwell on that for a little bit. Because sometimes in the midst of everything, it gets lost in the noise, you know? But people say this, but people say that. But the reality is, documented by biblical authors and non-biblical authors, is that there's a man that gave his life for you and for me, and he rose again. So, close your eyes, don't focus on anybody else, just do your time with God. Because I believe there are, there's three people in this room, three kinds of people. The Holy Spirit told me he's going to show me. So, you just do your time with God. The first group who are you've walked away from God and you said, no more. I don't want to have anything to do with this. This religious circle, I'm done. But brother, sister, I want to tell you today that it is so much more than that. It is so much more than that. It is a relationship restored. It is a love communicated. It is a sacrifice made on your behalf. And if that's you, you've had enough of this, just come back to him. The way the prodigal son did. Where he says, I've sinned, I've done this, but the father says, we're going to throw a party because my son was dead, now he's alive. He welcomes you with open arms. But I pray when you come back this time, let there be such a transformation. It's not just a tingly feeling, but a life change. That's the first group. And I want to share with you, just go back. Come back. And then there's a second group of people here where you've just been kind of complacent, you know? You're just like, oh, it is if it is. If the Bible says it is, it is. If it doesn't really matter. I'm just going to live day to day doing my own thing and stuff like that. Let me tell you something, please, please, please. And I say this because I love you, sister, brother. The traffic rules of the road will apply to you whether or not you read the driver's manual. There will be a day where Jesus will return and you'll have to answer for how you lived. And whether or not you believe in him, this will apply to you. What the Bible says will apply to you. Even if you don't believe it, you reject it and all that, it will still apply to you. Just like how the driver's manual, everything it says there, when you choose to drive on the road, every rule there applies to you whether or not you choose to read that. Are you catching what I'm saying here? And so I pray that you heed the warning, you see the blessing, and you commit to the person. That's Jesus. It's you. I pray that this is not just, you know, one shot kind of thing. You feel good for you, whoever you are, that I've just been complacent. But instead, it'd be like a ramp that launches you into being on fire for him. And if you don't know how to, especially if you're a young person, please come up to me. Let's walk alongside each other and let's do this. If you're an adult, hey, approach one of the pastors, man. It's life and death. Eternity's on the line here. It's a pretty big deal. We do this because we love you. We do this because we've seen and known what is on the line. It's not just because we want more numbers. It's because we love. We want people to know this because we love them, because we are just caught up with the love that God has and says, this is what's going to happen, no matter what. Now, it's up to you to do something about it, but this is actually what's going to happen. So if that's you, let this be like a ramp that says, Jesus, I'm all for it now. No more being lukewarm or cold. I'm going all out for you, man. Just pray that in your spirit. And there's one more that's kind of, well, I guess there's four now, but there's one more. You're angry at God. There's a third group of people in here. You're angry at God for one way, shape, or form. I'm not entirely sure why, but it's just what the Holy Spirit kind of put in my heart. You're angry for, I don't know, maybe your kids went astray. There's a tragedy that struck your family. There's something you can't explain. There's too much evil in the world. Whatever reason that you're angry at God. I just want to tell you, straight up, there are things in your life the enemy wants you to blame God, but it's actually the enemy doing it. And if that's you, I want you to know that God is for you, not against you. He really, really is for you. And the last is there's maybe some people in here who have never really committed your life to Jesus. What does that mean? It's more than just a religious saying. It's you giving your life, and when you give your life to something, somebody, it will change the way you are, especially when it comes to Jesus. If that's you, I want to tell you, really think about it. Because I gave my life to Jesus, and my life changed forever. Changed for the best. But if you're going to do it, don't do it half-heartedly. It's got to be all or nothing. It's got to penetrate deep into your soul where the way you live starts to change. You begin to love what he loves. You begin to love who he loves. So I don't want to just say, you know, just commit yourself to Jesus. I want to say, think about it. But if you have thought about it and you're ready, you just open your hands and you just begin to pray. Father, I give you my life. I give you my heart. I give you my spirit. You take lordship. forgive me of my sins. I'm sorry. I've been away. But I'm coming back now. You are now going to be on the driver's seat of my life. I surrender to you completely and absolutely. Sit there, just spend time with God for a bit. The worship team's going to play whatever the Holy Spirit puts in your heart. And then I'll pass it on to Pastor Richard here.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Come to the altar where Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar where Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets. Is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar.
Everybody will be here. This coming Friday is the Good Friday. So please don't hold your Bible study. We'll all be coming together here to have our Good Friday service. And it starts from 7 to 9. Amen? I don't know why it's called Good Friday. There's one thing in mind that I just came to my mind. Why Jesus came? Why did He die? Because in that particular Friday, He paid the penalty of our sins. So this coming Friday, we'll be remembering what God has done for us. Why did He die for us? And I think it will give us a better perspective on why we ought to follow Him, why we love Him, why we worship Him. Would you say amen? We'll see you on Friday. Amen. Father, we just want to thank You for Your words today. Thank You for Your message. I just pray that you take it deep, deep into our inner core, our inner self, Lord God. When there are times that we would be tempted to go astray from you, Lord, help us remember what you have done for us on the cross, not to condemn us, not to feel us guilty, but to help us remember how much you loved us, Lord God. So, Father, we just give you back all the glory and honor. Lord Jesus, we thank you for dying on our behalf. We thank you for coming here. We thank you for paying the penalty of our sins and making us debt-free, O Lord. So to you be all the glory and honor, power and praise as you fill us with your presence always. Church, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord surround you with his favor like a shield. And this I declare in the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody will say, amen. Amen. Church, thank you for coming. That's the end of our service for today.